Just for me, I'll have saints of all ages, they will kneel at his feet. Around the throne, but in my new home, when I look out the window, I'll see the face of my King. Just one look will do to prove it's a room, a room with a view. There's only one reason why I'll have a home there. I'll go there because Jesus died for my sin. And though I'm not worthy, and so undeserving, because I just one look will do.
down, and oh, my soul so weary. When troubles come and my heart burden be, and I am still and wait here in the silence until you come and sit a while with me. You raise me up so I can't stand on mountains. You raise me up.
Bon après-midi tout le monde. Just a notice, there is this vehicle, PD322. Your lights are on. PD322. Good afternoon again, sisters and brothers. Can we all stand for the arrival of the Acting Governor General of St. Lucia, His Excellency Cyril Errol Charles.
Yeah, 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 oh, yeah. If you give a little more than you take, and if you try to fix more than you break, if you're the kind who takes the time to help a stranger in the rain, there's a place for people like you. If you stand up for those down on their knees, and lend a voice to those who cannot speak. If you shine a little light, give sight to the ones who've lost their way. There's a place for people like you. I've heard up there the streets are made of gold.
At this moment, sisters and brothers, we'll be hearing some tributes from the Frederick brothers, Jasmara, Jeremy, Vitus Frederick, Keitha Frederick, and MacDonald Dixon as well. Keitha will do the eulogy and the others will do a tribute. So we now call on those persons who are prepared to do the tributes. Mr. Dixon is coming. Keitha, you call Mr. Dixon. He's coming. So you all could sit. You can go ahead.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for being here and sharing with us in this occasion. This tribute that I will be reading would be from all the siblings of my father, Keith, and therefore the language that you hear would be as if it's one of the siblings who would be reading, yes? Keith, or Skippy, as he was affectionately called by his siblings, was born in the sixth place in the line of 13 children. He was the glue that seemed to bridge the gap between the older and the younger siblings. Thus, he appeared to have been purposefully put in the center of his siblings. We hold many fond memories of our brother Keith, and I'd just like to share a few. Ralph recalls playing with Keith, who was the sibling born directly after him when they were younger. Keith was always in pursuit of Ralph as they raced after each other. And I, well, that should be Nabel, because Nabel was supposed to be reading this. Siki recalled that when they were children playing on the Lapansi Road, they would try to swiftly hide when they spotted Keith approaching, because he sometimes carried a whip behind him to beat them and exclaim, "Go in your books." Vitus recounts that Keith had a great sense of rhythm and was rather musical growing up, always humming a tune or singing a song. He distinctly recalls Keith singing one particular song, and forgive me if this was beyond my years. Cecilia, you're breaking my heart. Forgive me, I'm not a singer. Since he was interested in a girl named Cecilia at the time. Keith enjoyed a variety of interests, including cricket, music, singing, and whistling. He also enjoyed spending time with his siblings, extended relatives, and friends. Keith was extremely close to all of his siblings, but although he was not a twin, one sibling in particular played the role of twin, and that was Jeff. The family could often joke about how quickly Keith would respond when Jeff called. He would be out of the door half-dressed whenever Jeff called to say that he was on his way. Dorcas remembers that she always felt welcome in Keith and Jean's house, especially when they resided at Marisol, which served as the family's primary gathering location. Keith was always willing to help whenever called upon. He was very handy, so much so that one of his sisters-in-law jokingly referred to him as MacGyver. overall, all of our siblings, and I'm sure many of you with us here today have fond memories of Keith. He was genuinely a remarkable person, and we are incredibly glad to have had the opportunity to know him. There won't be a day that we don't think about you, dear brother. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'd just like to share a short tribute to my dad on behalf of his children. In the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians, chapter 13, verse 11, Paul wrote, "When I was a child, I spoke as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. It was only in my adulthood that I came to understand who my father really was to us, especially as a parent. My parents, while guiding us, always allowed us to make life choices and decisions on our own, with some mistakes along the way without being too overbearing. When discussing what we would do when we got older, my parents, and especially my dad, is quoted as saying, 'My children will always have a place in my home.' The English author and novelist Elizabeth Gaskell wrote, 'A wise parent humors the desire for independent action so as to become the friend and advisor when his absolute rule shall cease.' I believe that this quote epitomized our parents' style of parenting, and especially my dad's. Daddy truly was a friend and advisor to me. I recently came to appreciate the qualities in my dad which made him an exemplary father. He lived his God-given purpose of being a provider, a protector, and a true partner to our mom. Provider. From an early age, my dad began his working life. He truly had an entrepreneurial spirit and successfully built his businesses, his companies from the ground up, while always managing to provide for us and giving us comforts that he never had for himself growing up. He always ensured that we all attained a tertiary education. Protector. Daddy, although not the tallest and most robust man, always stood tall to us. His big voice was always intimidating to would-be suitors or friends who would call the house. However, one experience from our childhood cemented for me what the role of a father was meant to be. When we were younger and carnival was a sight to behold, our parents took us to town to see the carnival bands parading through Castries. We stood strategically near the corner of the boulevard and Bridge Street under what was formerly the J.Q. Charles building to witness the spectacle. A huge truck with sounds of burning flames, I believe, made its way down Bridge Street until a feud of some sort broke out and stone throwing ensued. A huge crowd of people began running towards where we were standing. Daddy sprang into protective mode and threw all of us, Mom, Charms, Lennon, and myself, against the glass show window of J.Q. Charles and literally spread his arms around us, using his body as a shield to protect us. My father literally covered us that day. And so we are grateful to know that we were loved by you, Daddy. To Jackie, you were always a phone call away. To me, you were always there, and as you put it in your own words, only a plane ride away. To Charms, you were always a shoulder to lean on. To Lennon, you were chubby. To Jasmara, she knew that family always came first with you. To AZ, the newest addition to our family, you were his best friend, his papa. We were blessed to have had a father like you. We hope and pray that you always knew how much we loved you. Cherry O Daddy Dudu, we will meet again soon. One day, rather, sorry.
The life of Keith Frederick. On August the 9th, 1946, at Lepanse Road in Castries, Keith, our cherished brother, was born to Lennox Eustace Frederick and Florence Mildred Green. He was the sixth child to be born to this union, which had produced a grand total of 13 children, 10 boys, one short of the required 11 for a complete cricket team, and 3 girls. After completing his education, Keith began his career in Viewfort alongside his older brother, Garnet. When Keith was approximately 23 years old, he welcomed his first child, Jacqueline Matura, now Jacqueline Houston, into the world. Later, he would meet Jeanne Lawrenson, the love of his life, and his future wife. The couple would go on to have 3 children together, Keitha, Charms, and Lennon. He would later welcome his 4th daughter, Jasmira Jeremy. Recently, Jan reminisced about their first meeting during his brief admission to the Victoria Hospital, where she served as a nurse. She went on to humorously reveal, and despite being a patient, he attempted to chat her while she cared for him. Days later, upon reporting to work, she learned that he had been discharged. However, as fate would have had it, this was only the beginning, as not long after this, Jan relocated to the Lepanse Road, and lo and behold, she encountered the very same gentleman. On April the 15th, 1974, Keith and Jan were married after 4 years of blissful courtship. He was regarded by his in-laws more as a brother than a brother-in-law, and they have fond recollections of how he was always there for them and served as a continual source of happiness, comfort, and unwavering support. Anyone who had the honor of meeting my brother Keith would describe him as a kind gentleman with a huge heart, a captivating smile, and an infectious laugh. Many people admired Keith's generous nature and practical temperament. He had a strong sense of initiative and was blessed with an entrepreneurial spirit. He was affectionately given the nickname KJ, an abbreviation for Keith and Jan, referring to the grocery shop they owned and operated in Bexon for more than 10 years. He was many things: a true friend to those closest to him, a loving husband, a doting father, and a caring brother, to name a few. He was Jan's life companion, best friend, and trusted confidant. He had a deep love and appreciation for his family and was always the one to bring his siblings together. We frequently gathered to play dominoes and table tennis together at his home in Marisol. Though he was not the most skillful of players, he made sure to have several games and activities available when we got together so that we had an opportunity to enjoy ourselves as a family. Even when, as brothers, we simply went out for drinks, he was always the one to initiate our limes and suggest that we explore the more remote parts of the north to escape from our comfort zones. As brothers, we had curated a number of locations that we loved to gather at in Le Bon or Chassin-Babineau, to name a few. There was no denying that Keith had a mischievous air about him, and many of his loved ones and friends fondly remember how much he enjoyed telling stories and cracking jokes about the hilarious misadventures we had experienced and playfully teasing those closest to him. I believe I speak on behalf of all of my brothers when I say that I cannot begin to fathom how we will ever be able to enjoy these outings again without Keith's presence. For this reason and countless others, he will be missed tremendously. His loss has truly left a colossal void in the hearts of all of us who knew him and loved him. A day will not go by where we do not think of our dearest brother, husband, father, and friend, Keith. May his soul rest in perfect peace. Amen. Thank you.
This is a rather tall order coming last in the sequence. My earliest reminiscences of Keith Frederick go way back to La Panse Road. The year, of course, is uncertain, but somewhere in the 50s. I recall two small boys, almost dressed alike and could pass for brothers, negotiating the slight incline by Mrs. Marius's house that leads straight into the road. I am alerted by a scream from a big sister. Keith, Nick, where do you think you're going? That's all the memory, but the names were firmly planted in my head, and I never forgot them. I knew Keith's elder brothers, Errol and Ralph, and their sister Dorcas from Anglican school. I also knew their eldest brother, Garnet, who I saw playing cricket on the road with the likes of Sir Julian Hunt, Stanley French, and Mr. Girard. Those were the old La Panse boys. But of course, when you lived in the village, such were the times. The population was small, and everybody knew everybody. My mother moved out after my grandmother died, and I lost sight of Keith and his sidekick, Nick, the two who made absconding a preoccupation, but who seemed not to have acquired the knack for running away comfortably. They always seemed to have got caught. Little did I know that later in life, my paths would cross with Keith again. This time, as young adults, eyes brimming with hope and yearning for a bright future. We became close through a mutual friend, John Elliott, who is here today, and the three of us paraded the length and breadth of this island in the pursuit of happiness, until we became inseparable. Keith was not an easy friend to understand, although he could be trusted implicitly. It was even worse when I cracked one of my frequent jokes with him as the subject. Once he said to me, "That's all you're good for. why you don't go and write Calypso and make money? Notwithstanding his absurdic wit, he could have you cracking up, especially when the joke was on you or on someone whom you knew. At election time, he showed his colors as a fanatic. And when I deliberately teased him with opposing views, he would invoke the wrath of St. Michael on me until I felt like the devil. However, there was an innate manly propriety about him, a veiled gentleness that warmed strangers to his company, which none of us had. He evoked comments from elder people like, "That boy is well brought up. He has good manners, we." While on transfer to Grenada, I was informed that Keith was courting and would marry one Jean Laurencin, who came to me as a surprise because I had been away for a while. And despite all efforts to be in attendance, disturbances on the island at the time ruled against me coming as the bank denied me leave. Soon, all three of us were married and went our separate ways with real life problems to solve, especially trying to resolve the mystery of how two strangers from two different houses can become one. Of course, this, I think all three of us, this was one of, was our main contention when we met at socials over drinks. There are no words to console a grieving family at this time. But to his wife, Jeanne, his children, Keitha, Charms, and Lennon, I can only say, hold firm. Time is a great healer. I've been there. I've done that. Cherish for now and always the memories. They are all you have. I will end, of course, with a poem by my friend and mentor, Derek Walcott, that I often refer to at these times, especially with advancing years, which I will share with you now. It's entitled Sea Canes. Half my friends are dead. I will make new ones, said Earth. No, give me them back as they were instead, with faults and all, I cried. Tonight I can snatch their talk from the faint surf's drone, through the canes, but I cannot walk on the moonlit leaves of ocean down that white road alone, or float with the dreaming motion of owls leaving Earth's load. O Earth, the number of friends you keep exceed those left to be loved. The sea canes by the cliff flash green and silver. They were the seraph lances of my faith, but out of what is lost grows something stronger that has the rational radiance of stone. Enduring moonlight further than despair, strong as the wind that through dividing canes bring those we love before us as they were, with faults and all, but nobler. Just there.
Thank you, family, for the tribute and eulogy. So again, sisters and brothers, we welcome you to the celebration of the life of our brother, Keith Leonard Frederick. Let us make this a real celebration, because this is who the man was, a man of celebration, a man who was witty, a man who was full of life, a man who brought smiles to the faces of all of us who knew him. So at this moment, we are going to prepare ourselves to begin the celebration of the funeral service.
Thank you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, the grace and peace of God our Father, who raised Jesus from the dead, be always with you.
And with your spirit.
Praise be God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all consolation. He comforts us in all our afflictions, and thus enables us to comfort those who are in trouble with the same consolation we have received from him. Blessed be God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Blessed be God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ.
I bless the body of Keith Leonard with the holy water that recalls his baptism, of which St. Paul writes, "All of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death. By baptism into his death, we were buried together with him, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead, we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with him by likeness to his death, so shall we be united with him by likeness to his resurrection." On the day of his baptism, Keith Leonard put on Christ. In the day of Christ's coming, may he be clothed with glory.
Our entrance hymn, "To God Be the Glory."
Rejoicing through Jesus the spray. O God, whose nature is always to forgive and to show mercy, we humbly implore you for your servant Keith Leonard, whom you have called to journey to you, and since he hoped and believed in you, grant that he may be led to our true homeland to delight in its everlasting joys. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
Be seated, please. Can the two readers come forward? The first reading, a reading from the prophet Isaiah, chapter 25, verses 6 to 9. The Lord will destroy death forever.
The Lord will destroy death forever. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will prepare for all peoples a banquet of rich food. On this mountain, he will remove the mourning veil, covering all peoples, and the shroud enwrapping all nations. He will destroy death forever. The Lord will wipe away the tears from every cheek. He will take away his people's shame everywhere on earth, for the Lord has said so. That day it will be said, "See, this is our God in whom we hoped for salvation. The Lord is one in whom we hoped. We exult and we rejoice that he has saved us." The word of the Lord.
Our psalm responds to the reading, "The Lord's my shepherd, he lives."
Shepherd, I'll not want. He makes me come to life. In pastures green, he leadeth me. The quiet waters cry. He lives. Righteousness in God is all next day. He lives.
Oh, yes,
he lives.
Oh, yes,
he lives.
Oh, yes, he lives.
I know that my Redeemer lives. He lives.
Oh, yes, he lives.
He lives.
Oh, yes, he lives.
He lives within my heart. Yet will I fear no ill, for thou art with me, and thy rod and staff comfort me. He lives.
Of my foe,
First letter of St. Paul to the Thessalonians, chapter 4, verses 13 to 18. We shall stay with the Lord forever.
We shall stay with the Lord forever. We want you to be quite certain, brothers, about those who have died, to make sure that you do not grieve about them like the other people who have no hope. We believe that Jesus died and rose again, and that it will be the same for those who have died in Jesus. God will bring them with him. We can tell you this from the Lord's own teachings, that any of us who are left alive until the Lord's coming will not have any advantage over those who have died. At the trumpet of God, the voice of the archangel will call out the command, and the Lord himself will come down from heaven. Those who have died in Christ will be the first to rise, and then those of us who are still alive will be taken up in the clouds together with them to meet the Lord in the air. So we shall stay with the Lord forever. With such thoughts as these, you should comfort one another. The word of the Lord.
We all stand to hail the good news.
Hallelujah, hallelujah,
hallelujah,
hallelujah,
hallelujah,
oh, hallelujah,
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 oh,
hallelujah,
it is my Father's will, says the Lord, that whoever believes in the Son shall have eternal life, and that I shall raise him up on the last day.
Hallelujah,
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 oh, hallelujah, hallelujah.
The Lord be with you
and with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory be to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God still, and trust in me. There are many rooms in my Father's house. If they were not, I should have told you. I am going now to prepare a place for you. And after I have gone and prepared you a place, I shall return to take you with me, so that where I am, you may be too. You know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said, Lord, we do not know where you are going, so how can we know the way? Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
On your behalf, I wish to recognize the presence of His Excellency, Mr. Harold Charles, as well as Dame Emerita, Paulette Louise, and any other dignitary we have among us whom I cannot see. I was not given a protocol list apart from these two. And also to welcome His Grace, Archbishop Gabriel Malzer, the clergy, and who are here to support Deacon Errol, who is a member of the clergy, a permanent deacon. So if you want your family to have plenty priests and deacons at your funeral, you have to add one to our numbers up here, whether as a priest or deacon, okay? Good. Two persons I know have been parish priests of Keith, Father Athanas and Father Quinlan, yeah? And others like Deacon Girard and the rest would have served while he was with us. It's hotter, but it's hotter down there. So avoid going there. Let's take it. Let's bear the heat here, but it's hotter down there. So let's avoid going down there, all right? On behalf of the clergy and all of us gathered here, we wish to extend to Jean, I don't know why they call you Jean, and your name is French, is Jean, yeah? To Jean and all the children, and to Deacon Errol and that clan of men just short of the cricket team, and the sisters, and all those who are associated with Keith in any way. We have a full house today. Did you see, Joanne? Okay, you have my permission. You could stand. The family members could stand and turn around and look at the church. Yes, all of these people came for you, all of them. Yes, okay? I'm making that observation because we, those of us who are here to come and support the bereaved at this difficult time, you are called ministers of consolation. Ministers of consolation. That your primary purpose here is to comfort and to console the bereaved. And presence is the way that it happens most. Not so much what we say to the members of the family, accept my sympathy and things like that. But the mere presence, because it meant that you left everything that you had to do for this afternoon to be here. It's not possible for them to see everybody either. Yeah? It will not be possible. But I think the very many heads that they saw would indicate the number of people who are here to support them. Our brother Keith died very suddenly. You would have heard that there was a gathering at Deacon Errol's home, and it was when he went home that night or early morning that he took ill and never recovered. It can happen to any one of us. Yeah, that suddenness of death One of those things that I pray for, Lord, you know, there are some kinds of death I wouldn't want. Yeah, the sudden ones, the accidental, the violent, for sure. That I don't mind, you know, having to suffer for a little while, yeah? Or a little old age, or a mixture of the two. But the sudden, the accidental, the violent, these do not give you any opportunity to say goodbye, yeah? And I think it is, when people are dying, there should be some kind of ritual of saying goodbye, of imparting blessing, of receiving blessings from others, the thank yous from friends and family members. I think we normally ritualize that parting as the last phase in our circle of life. But as you can see, it does not happen with everybody. And even if I desire it, I may not be afforded that opportunity. And it's for this reason that each one of us must prepare every day and prepare now, because we do not know whether we will see tomorrow. Yeah? Sometimes it has happened that persons who were present at the very funeral ceremony never saw the night, never saw the sun go down. I don't wish it for you, but it may very well happen, because as Jesus always said in the lessons, the parables he taught his disciples, he always said, stay awake because you do not know the day or the hour. So the staying awake is a spiritual disposition of always thinking about death. On Monday, Monsignor Anthony and myself were present at the funeral, a memorial service, because the funeral service had already taken place in Canada, of Mr. Claude Griffith. And yes, there were tributes by close friends. And one of the things we remarked in the eulogy, I think it was, that here it was that this gentleman, Mr. Griffith, was not afraid of living out his faith. And then Monsignor Anthony and myself remarked that in eulogies and tributes, you hear all kinds of glowing things about people and what they did and what they did not do, where they went and where they did not go, but you hardly hear anything about their relationship with God. And many of us have lived that publicly, yeah, for everyone to see, as though it doesn't matter. But this is the one that really matters. Here is crunch time. Because now that we have reached that point where we are separated from the earthly life, that is the moment that we should be looking towards glory. However, glory will be attained depending on the type of life we lived here when we were on earth. Glory can only be attained depending on the quality of life we had while we lived here. The quality of life with God, the quality of life with our brothers and sisters. That is what will determine where we go from there. And so, when we gather for a funeral, we are here for a few things. Firstly, we are here to commend the soul of our brother to the Lord, that he may remember his kind deeds and reward him with eternal life in his kingdom. We are here to comfort the bereaved members of the family. We know how painful it is, those of us who have been there, and some of us have been there quite recently. We know what the pain of loss is. And it takes time for healing to take place. Sometimes a greater part of 2 years or more.
So our presence here, as I mentioned in the beginning, is that we are here as ministers of consolation to comfort the bereaved. Thirdly, we are here for our own selves, because we must and we ought to reflect on our mortality. Every time we come to a funeral service, we have to ask, what about me? Am I ready for this? Now, this may sound like a morbid subject to even consider, but it is important, since we do not know the when, the where, and the how, since we do not know, we ought to give serious consideration to what is the condition of my soul. Now, whether one believes in the afterlife or not does not change the fact that there is one, and that we are going to be judged according to the things we did, good or bad, while we live this life, and there is going to be a determination by God as to where we go from there. Whether we believe in the afterlife or not, but there is one, because Jesus told us so. And you heard it in the gospel. When the disciple asked, where are you going, Lord? We do not know the way. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And other times he said, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, even though he or she dies, will live. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. So never die means eternal life with God. That after we leave this earth and we have found to be worthy to be with God, there we share eternal life with him in his kingdom, where there is no more death, no more suffering, no more pain, no more dying. And this is what is and has to be comforting to the bereaved. Because when death occurs, as the Book of Wisdom tells us, it seems like a disaster. It seems like annihilation. It seems so, because it is so difficult to fathom. But when we have lived well, there is a place awaiting us in the kingdom. And that is where we shall see those who have preceded us in death, whether they be members of our family, our friends, our colleagues, members of our church communities. That is where we will encounter them. And that gives us hope, so that even though we are pained right now by that loss, but that faith is not in vain. That hope is not in vain, because Jesus has promised us that we will see our loved ones again. So Jane, we hope that in the coming days and weeks and months, you would remember Keith as fondly as you do now, but the pain will be lessened. That is what the journey of bereavement does for us. The pain is lessened. And what keeps us going are the memories that we have, the cherished memories that we have of our loved ones. But if there are to be memories, those memories must be created. They don't happen just like that. We have to create the memories. It means that we have to find time to spend with each other, find time to play, find time to have fun with each other. And it is those great moments, as we recall them when our loved one is gone, These are the memories that bring us great comfort, and then we find reasons to move on. Yes, this is our faith, that death does not end in the tomb. Death does not end there. There is life beyond the grave, and that is what we aspire to as Christians. So even though today we may be saying goodbye to our brother Keith, and that we will not see him again in the flesh, the hope that we have, the Christian hope that we have, is that when all will be consumed, when the Lord will return and call us all back to himself, we will be able to see loved ones again. What a joy it will be on that day. Amen.
Those with the intercessory prayers, can you come forward? Those with the intercessory prayers. Denzel Frederick.
Don't call their names, they know their names, please. We invite you to please stand. And I want you to check your phones. I just heard some messages coming through on a phone. So check your phone, put it on silent or vibrate.
That was Jesus calling.
So that if you are on call and you're expecting a call or a message, we will all not be disturbed by it. Brothers and sisters, Jesus Christ is risen from the dead and sits at the right hand of the Father, where he intercedes for his church, confident that God hears the voices of those who trust in the Lord Jesus, we join our prayers to his. And so we pray.
Prayer for the church. We pray for the church, the clergy, and the religious, and all God's people, that God may continue to bless them in the ministry. Grant them wisdom and knowledge and insight that they may be able to guide God's people in the ways of truth, justice, and love. We pray to the Lord.
Somebody's praying, Lord, Kumbaya. Somebody's praying, Lord, Kumbaya.
Prayer for the sick and shut-in. We pray for those who are sick and shut in, for those who are suffering from all kinds of ailments and diseases, that God may grant them the healing necessary and the courage and the strength to persevere in their lives. Help them to endure and recognize that their sufferings can never be in vain, as Jesus himself endured suffering for our own redemption. We pray to the Lord.
Somebody's praying, Lord, Kumbaya. Somebody's praying, Lord, Kumbaya.
Prayer for the family of the deceased. We pray for the family of this deceased, Keith Frederick, his wife, his children, his siblings, and all other relations, that God may grant them peace, strength, and consolation as they mourn the loss of their loved one, knowing that death is the gateway to eternal life and freedom. We pray to the Lord.
Somebody's praying, Lord, Kumbaya. Somebody's praying, Lord, Kumbaya.
Prayer for the deceased. I pray for my granduncle, Keith Frederick, that God in his mercy may grant him forgiveness of his sins and shortcomings while in this world, and grant him a place with his angels and saints in his heavenly kingdom. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer.
Somebody's praying, Lord, Kumbaya. Somebody's praying, Lord, Kumbaya.
Prayer for the nation. We pray for St. Lucia and for an end to the situation of crime and violence in our country, in the Caribbean, and in the world. We pray that God may grant comfort and healing to all victims of crime and violence, and to grant all perpetrators of crime a life-changing conversion, a spirit of peace, of love, and forgiveness in their hearts. We pray to the Lord.
Somebody's praying, Lord, kumbaya. Somebody's praying, Lord, kumbaya.
Let us pray for all those who have lost their lives, especially those who died in the train crashes in India, more than 280. Some people have also died in Haiti because of flooding and the recent earthquake. And anybody else who may have died out of natural disasters, those who may have died because of accidents, and those who may have died violently, we commend them all to the grace and mercy of God, that he may, in his goodness, forgive whatever sins they may have committed out of human frailty and grant them eternal peace in his kingdom. We pray to the Lord.
Somebody's praying, Lord, kumbaya. Somebody's praying, Lord, kumbaya.
Finally, let us pray that the Lord may protect each one of us here and our loved ones against a sudden and an unprovided death. We pray to the Lord.
Somebody's praying, Lord, kumbaya. Somebody's praying, Lord, kumbaya.
Lord God, giver of peace and healer of souls, hear the prayers of the Redeemer, Jesus Christ, and the voices of your people whose lives were purchased by the blood of the Lamb. Forgive the sins of all who sleep in Christ, and grant them a place in the kingdom through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
This is a funeral mass, so there will be Holy Communion. And those of you who are Catholics and can receive Holy Communion, please avail yourselves of that opportunity.
And during this time, we'll be taking up a collection. Please be seated.
I lift my name.
of your love.
Nous avons fait la tout ça nous fait, tout ça nous nie, papa nous ca, au fait jolie, tout ça nous y
my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
As we humbly present to you these sacrificial offerings, O Lord, for the salvation of your servant, Keith Leonard, we beseech your mercy that he who did not doubt your Son to be a loving Savior may find in him a merciful judge who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit. Up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. Of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your
as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit.
Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Gabriel, our Bishop, and all the clergy.
Remember your servant, Keith Leonard, whom you've called today from this world to yourself. Grant that he who was united with your son in a death like his may also be one of him in his resurrection.
Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the Blessed Apostles, St. Lucy, and all the saints who are pleasing for all the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and we praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
Our Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, holy be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Our Father who art in heaven, holy be your name.
Holy be your name.
Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Our Father who art in heaven, holy be your name.
Holy be your name.
Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever."
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Lord, bind us together with bonds that cannot be broken. Bind us together, Lord, bind us together, Lord, bind us.
Takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy you should enter into my house. For Holy Communion, there will be five stations, two in the center half of the church, the halfway mark, two up front by the casket, and one by the pillar on this side. So those of you on this side may have to do a little squeezing to get your way out, because those who are coming in the middle aisle, you are asked to go out on the side aisle and not return on the main aisle.
During communion, we sing the hymn, I am the bread of life.
Upon the
and I will raise him up, and I will raise him up, and I will raise him up on the last day.
Son left us in the sacrament of his body, food for the journey. Mercifully grant that, strengthened by it, our brother Keith Leonard may come to the eternal table of Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Please sit. During the signing of the register, we have a special rendition by Disciple Voices. Thank you.
We are called to discipleship. Hungry babies crying for the food they cannot have. Preaching every prison to every man in jail. Spread the gospel of Jesus Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit. Let your voices cry out loud. Preach the word that Jesus gave. Live the life that Jesus did. And walk the path he walked as he journeyed through this life. In the streets of our ghettos, our teaching must be done. Claiming Jesus as Savior, who brings light and hope to the world. Reach out to your brother, tell him that you care. Help him bear his burden that sin has brought on him. Let your voices cry out loud. Preach the words that Jesus gave. Live the life that Jesus did. And walk the path he walked as we journeyed through this life. Ooh.
Brother Keith was a member of the Disciples' Voices, and he was also a Kosiista, a member of the Kosio movement.
Please stand. His Grace will do the final commendation. Before he does that, I just want to remind all Catholics that tomorrow is Corpus Christi. Okay, so make it a priority because it's not a holiday. It's a holy day of obligation for all Catholics. So the beach has to be given no priority. Not second, huh? None. Church first. Cathedral, where His Grace is going to preside, the Mass is at 3 o'clock. Same time here at Grosile. So find your church and go and worship. That is the central aspect of our faith, the Eucharist.
Before we begin, I would like to extend my condolences to the bereaved family, the Frederick family. Trusting in God, we have prayed together for our brother Keith Leonard. And now we come to the last farewell. There is sadness in parting. But we take comfort in the hope that one day we shall see our brother Keith again and enjoy his friendship. Although this congregation will disperse in sorrow, the mercy of God will gather us together again in the joy of His kingdom. Therefore, let us console one another in the faith of Jesus Christ.
During the final commendation, we sing the hymn, All I Ask of You.
and present him to God the Most High. Receive his soul and present him to God the Most High. Saints of God, come to his aid. Hasten to meet him, angels of the Lord. Receive his soul and present him to God the Most High. May Christ to call you, take you to himself. May angels lead you to Abraham's side. Receive his soul and present him to God the Most High. Eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him. Receive his soul and present him to God the Most High.
We commend our brother Keith Lennon in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with them on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you have bestowed on Keith in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and our friendship, our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn towards us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant and help us to remain, to comfort one another with assurance of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our brother forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord. May the angels lead you into paradise. May the martyrs come to welcome you and take you to the holy city, the new and eternal Jerusalem. May the choirs of angels welcome you and lead you to the bosom of Abraham, where Lazarus is born no longer. May you find eternal rest. Eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord.
And let perpetual life shine.
May his soul rest in peace. May his soul and the souls of all the faithful departed through the mercy of God rest in peace.
I want to also recognize the presence of some pastors and members of the Seventh-day Adventist Church who are here with us this afternoon because Jean's and Keith's children, I think the two daughters, are of the Seventh-day Adventist religion. So we thank all of you for coming and for supporting them and all of us in prayer. This, there will not be a burial, but a cremation. So we ask that you stay in your places and allow the family members and the Governor General and the Governor Emerita to leave after the family. Stay in your places until the casket has got to the front of the church. Thank you.
One notice before the recessional. All is invited to the repast at the Causeway Resource Center, just up the road. Our recessional hymn, Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone.
I want.
my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood his mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. My streams are gone, I've been set free. My Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood his mercy brings, unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow, to shine. God who called me below will be mine, will be forever mine, will be forever.
The praise.